Marsha O. Thomas, who lives in Arlington, Texas. Ms. Thomas writes, "Dear Dr. Alan McLaurin, I am writing to express thanks to your church for the kindness shown to me by two of your congregants, two men who were attending the parking lot for the Alabama-Georgia game. After we parked in your lot, I started to feel ill and was very concerned about what to do. However, they very graciously allowed me inside to use the restroom twice. With that kindness, they saved the day for me, for I'm sure I would have otherwise been sick on the street. This caring for others without hesitation that these gentlemen showed to me is a reflection of the generosity of spirit which must surely permeate your church. And for that, I thank you. In gratitude for the help given to me, I have included a donation to the church to further the missions and strengthen the presence of your congregation in the community. May God bless you all." Marsha Thomas. And she included a $100 check, which I have already placed in the offering basket. You never know who you may encounter. You never know what some small kindness may mean to somebody. They could have said, "We don't have any public restrooms," because we really don't. We don't generally open up the church for folks to use the restroom, but they used discernment that day to say, "This woman needs help. She needs to be able to avail herself of some facilities." And who better to open their doors than God's church? Somebody ought to say amen. Amen. From the text that has already been read in our hearing from Mark chapter 1, I want to pull out verse 16. As Jesus passed along the Sea of Galilee, he saw Simon and his brother Andrew casting a net into the sea, for they were fishermen. For the next 4 weeks, I want to preach a series, since we are in ordinary time, evidenced by the green liturgical cloths, entitled "Ordinary Time, Extraordinary Possibilities." Ordinary time, extraordinary possibilities. And the sermon today is entitled, "When Jesus Shows Up on Your Job." As Jesus passed along the Sea of Galilee, he saw Simon and his brother Andrew casting a net into the sea, for they were fishermen. When we begin this passage, Jesus has taken up where John the Baptist left off once he was placed in prison. Jesus is proclaiming the good news of God, that the kingdom of God is near. Now, Jesus could have proclaimed that message alone, but he knew what his future held. He knew he would need disciples to assist him during his ministry and to carry on the ministry once he was gone. The first people Jesus calls are Simon and his brother Andrew. They are fishermen. The text states that they were fishing when Jesus came walking along. They were in the act of performing their jobs, casting their nets into the lake. They were brothers, so we might infer that this was the family business, fishing. Jesus calls them to follow him, and they immediately stop fishing and follow Jesus. Then Jesus goes on a little further and sees James and John fishing with their father Zebedee. And the text states that they were in the boat with Zebedee and the hired men. This tells us that they are in a family business and a profitable one at that, since they were able to hire assistants. So the first thing we notice about these men is that they were already working. They were not just sitting around waiting for Jesus to come walking along. They were engaged in work. Somebody ought to say amen. Secondly, we notice the type of work they are doing. They are fishing, and it is not recreational fishing. They are not on the yacht or the bass boat, kicked back with their shoes off, drinking fishing beverages, and eating sandwiches their wives had prepared. No, these men are working hard. They are casting nets, and if you've ever seen a commercial fishing net, you know it is huge to catch huge quantities of fish. To haul in the take, one must be quite strong. Also, to be a successful commercial fisherman, one must be accustomed to changes in the weather, knowledgeable about the tides, and able to withstand the environment, particularly in this case, the Galilean summer. Now, here's something we may miss in the story because it's written rather benignly. Jesus comes along and begins to talk with these men. If these men were engaged in work, Jesus would have had to get their attention. We assume they do not know Jesus because nowhere in the text does it say they had been previously introduced. So in this text, Jesus is a complete stranger to these men. However, he is apparently able to get their attention to speak with him. Then something extraordinary occurs. Jesus calls them to follow him. And the text does not tell us that Jesus explained what was happening or what was about to happen. He does not tell them who he was or anything. He did not give them the 411 on the call he was issuing. And he didn't use a lot of words. He simply said, "Come follow me and I will make you fishers of people." Isn't that an interesting choice of words? It sums up their whole ministry in two or three words. Perhaps Jesus was aware that these men were not ones for a lot of jibber jabber, a whole lot of mindless chatter, a whole lot of talking loud and saying nothing. You know, often in our society, we hear people talking about a subject, and instead of using simple language, they are talking over everybody's heads, pontificating, using $20 words when $2 words will do. That's what I like about Jesus. He never did that. He always spoke clearly, saying what he meant and meaning what he said. A lot of times we get caught up in the fallacy that if people are using big words, they are educated about what they are speaking. And that may well be true. But let me tell you something. Knowledge should never serve as a replacement for spiritual discernment. It's good to be educated. We need to be educated. But if something doesn't feel right in your spirit about what somebody is telling you, you better pray and check it out for yourself. As a matter of fact, in our text for today. But the next thing we notice in the story is that the men obeyed Jesus and followed him. The text said they dropped everything and immediately followed Jesus. They stopped right in their tracks. They didn't tell Jesus, wait, let me go pick up my check. Or let me go home and tell my family what I'm about to do. Or let me get some things together. Or come back next week, Jesus. I'm not prepared to go with you today. They immediately left their work and followed Jesus. Now, why is spiritual discernment important here? I think it is important, first of all, because these men were adults. They were children or youth who might have been easily swayed by some smooth talker or persuasive charmer. They weren't gullible men either. These were hard-working men who had lives to lead. Secondly, they were Jewish men. In this context, first century Palestine, that would have meant they were already religious. They were members of God's chosen ones, of God's Israelite family, and presumably they went to the temple and studied the scriptures and believed in God. They knew of the messianic prophecies. They knew about the text that told and foretold of a Messiah to come. But let us remember that in first century Palestine, messiahs were a dime a dozen. Many had come forward to say that they were the one that the people had waited on, and these men had not followed anyone before who had claimed this. So what was it about Jesus that made them drop everything? I believe it is because God spoke to their spirits and told them, "This is my son. Follow him." I don't believe these men would have dropped everything and answered Jesus' call unless they truly believed in their hearts that they had heard from God the call to follow him. They used spiritual discernment to hear and answer God's call. Furthermore, they had not been told what they were supposed to do. Jesus did not give them a job description or ask for resumes to see if they had what it took. Jesus knew they had what was needed. They were accustomed to hard work. They were used to being outdoors and not being members of the elite. We know that they walked everywhere they went. This would be important, because Jesus was not calling them to a life of ease, but to a ministry in which their very lives would be risked and ultimately for several ended. Perhaps more importantly, they were willing to give up everything, family, success, their established places in the community and stability, all to follow an unknown, ordinary man who in the minds of many was just another false messiah. They immediately dropped their nets. Well, Pastor, why should that be so earth-shaking for me, you may ask? I already believe in God and in Jesus. That may be true, but I'm not here to ask you whether you believe in God or in Jesus. I'm here to ask you a simple question. What would you do if Jesus showed up on your job? Well, maybe I should ask, has Jesus already shown up on your job? And if so, what did you do? Were you working? Was Jesus able to get your attention? transformative, not just for them, but for their communities. Then it meant heeding Jesus' call to do something extraordinary. To do that, they had to walk away from the ordinary, from the everyday understanding of what their work was, of what their lives were meant to be. They had to leave the familiar, especially their familiar sense of comfort, of complacency, of knowing exactly what would happen day in and day out of every day, going out in the boat and casting the net on this side and casting the net on that side and pulling in the daily haul and going back in and perhaps preparing the fish to sail and then going home only to get up the next morning and do it all over again in order to take advantage of Jesus' potential for something transformative. They had to let go of the ordinary. Would we be able to do that? If Jesus just showed up at our offices, at our corporate businesses, in our cubicles, in our classrooms, at our own stores, at our homes, in the hospitals, at the clinics, at the polling places, would we be able to stop what we are doing long enough to pay attention to the fact that Jesus is in our midst? Yeah. Or would we be so busy marking time that we would miss his presence? If we stopped to listen, would we hear what he was saying to us? Would we heed it? Would it matter? Or would we simply dismiss Jesus by saying, yeah, Jesus, all that's nice, but I got work to do. Or Jesus, you need to get along now because I got bills to pay and you're interfering with my ability to do my job. Or Jesus, I don't have time for all of this. You're messing up my schedule and you're really cutting into my lunch for you. But I have news for us. Jesus is showing up on our jobs and in our homes each and every day. Amen. Jesus does show up and Jesus talks to us. Jesus calls us to a new way of thinking, of living, of acting, of being. Jesus wants to transform our lives from the simple, ordinary to the absolutely extraordinary. Yes. You may be thinking to yourself, who, me? Little old nobody me. That's why I believe Jesus called the people that he called to follow him. Yes. Because they were nobody that the world thought was powerful, yes, or popular, or well-known, or rich, or famous. They weren't on Instagram. Yes. They weren't on Twitter. Yes. They weren't all over the networks. Yes. Jesus called ordinary women and men. In this text, fishermen, everyday, ordinary, workaday, dirt under their fingernails, people who toiled every day for what they had, whatever living they were able to eke out. God uses ordinary people. Yes, yes. Calls ordinary people to do extraordinary things, but we have to be willing to see Jesus, yes, to notice Jesus, to pay attention to Jesus, to hear what Jesus is saying to disciples. Disciples were dirty. They smelled the fish. They were blue collar workers. You couldn't get any more ordinary than that. You may say, God, I made mistakes in my life and people know about them, but the disciples were not perfect. They were rough, unpolished, and aware of their shortcomings. The word tells us all have sinned and fallen short of God's glory. That is no excuse not to obey God's call. And some say, but God, what if I falter while I'm answering this call? God knows our failings, just like God knew the disciples' faults. God knew they would fall asleep on Jesus. God knew they wouldn't always understand what Jesus was talking about. God knew they would abandon Jesus at his most critical moment, but God also knew they were willing to do the work. That they would believe the gospel and they would carry the gospel throughout the earth. God knew they would be obedient. Why? Because immediately they dropped their nets. What do you do when God calls you? What do you do when Jesus shows up on your job? Remember, this is the year of no fear. And in this year of no fear, Jesus is showing up on our jobs, calling us to drop our nets. And for those of you saying, well, I'm retired, I don't work a job. Yes, you do. If you get up every day, that means you got a purpose. You're supposed to be doing something. And something for the body of Christ, something for the kingdom of God, something that says, yes, I follow Jesus. Make up in your mind today that you're not going to run any longer, that you're not going to make any more excuses, that you're not going to rationalize, you're not going to debate the pros and cons any longer. You're going to go forth with God's promise that God will make everything all right. You can't change your age. Maybe you're 45, 55, 65, just figuring out what God is calling you. You might live to be 115. So that means you got another 40, 50, 60 years of ministry. Drop your net. Follow Jesus. You can't change your race. Maybe the field God is calling you is lacking people who look like you. That may be the point God is trying to make. Drop your net and follow Jesus. You can't change what happened in the past. That may be the very story God wants you to tell. Without a test, you can't have a testimony. God will give you courage to change the things you can. You have family responsibilities. So what? God has a cattle on a thousand hills and will make a way. You're afraid to go back to school or get training. There are others who travel that same path. Drop your net and follow Jesus. You don't have a clear picture of what you're supposed to do. So what? Pray and ask for wisdom and discernment, and God will reveal God's plan in God's time. No, God won't show it all to you at once. Because if God shows us too much, we may fear and turn back. We may get scared and say, I can't do all of that. But if you get just enough light for the step you're on, get moved. Has Jesus shown up on your job yet? If not, be awake. Because he's there. You just haven't noticed. The doors of the church are always open. And at this time, we intentionally invite persons into relationship as we are able to let us stand. We invite persons into relationship, not religion, but relationship. We invite those who may be seeking a church